Copyright University of Auckland, all rights reserved. The content and delivery of lectures in this course are protected by copyright. Material belonging to others may have been used in these lectures and copied by and solely for the educational purposes of the university under licence. You may record the lectures for the purposes of private study or research, but you may not sell, alter, or further reproduce or distribute any part of these lectures to any other person. Failure to comply with the terms of this warning may expose you to legal action for copyright infringement by the copyright owner and/or disciplinary action by the university.
Okay, tēnā rā koutou katoa. Rai rangatira mā huri nō te whare, nau mai hara mai. Kia ora everyone, it is my pleasure on behalf of the Tōmaiora Research Group to welcome you all today to our March seminar and to introduce our fabulous speaker. Many of you will know Rhys from the work that he does keeping our institution in line and developing the Hauora Māori domain and working within the medical curriculum. You might know him through his research around educating for equity and marae food gardens. But outside of these four walls, he's also doing a lot of work advocating for Māori and for all citizens. Locally, I know he's doing a lot of work trying to keep our roads safe for everyone. He does that one pair of bike shorts at a time. putting in all the Ks, riding from Mount Albert and out to Tāmaki and back home again every day. But he also works hard to keep our government and international governments in line when it comes to protecting the climate and protecting all people and Indigenous people in particular. So we welcome Rhys today. He's going to talk to us, I think, building on their editorial that was in the NZMJ 2 weeks ago. So I love the intro. Unless you're a politician, activist or business leader, there is a high chance your eyes will glaze over with talk of the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. So I think Rhys is going to help with that glaze. He's going to deglaze and demystify and deconstruct what it is that's happening in terms of the CTPPA. That's why I got to introduce him. I had to say CPTPP, that was the trick. He's going to talk to us about that today, and we look forward to having a bit of a discussion at the end. So welcome, Rhys.
Kia ora. Kia ora, Sarah Jane. Me ngā mihi nunui ka koutou katoa. Ai, ko Rhys Jones tōku ingoa, he uri aho o Ngāti Kahungunu. So very pleased to be here today. I do have to say I kind of stepped in, I think, at slightly short notice for this seminar, partly because I think it's really topical, and actually it's become even more so since I agreed to do it, in that there's a whole public consultation going on now, which is a relatively limited timeframe around the new look Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which is really conveniently titled CPTPP, just to confuse and, you know, throw people out even more. So I don't pretend to be any great expert on this agreement or even on sort of trade agreements in health. I think, you know, it takes probably people with legal and economic and all sorts of other expertise to really fully understand the implications of these kind of modern trade agreements. But what I do, the sort of perspective I do bring is particularly from my work around climate change and health and thinking about trade agreements and particularly ones like the Trans-Pacific Partnership as real threats to healthy climate action and to doing the things that we need to do, not only to protect our health against the impacts of climate change, but also to do the things that we should be doing now to improve population health and equity. So hopefully I'll share a few thoughts and I'll try to leave a reasonable amount of time for discussion and questions and things at the end. So, yes. And what I will be touching on really is sort of a whole lot of these broader processes that are going on, particularly thinking around globalization and capitalism, neoliberalism, climate change and sort of global environmental changes. The increasing concentration of wealth and increasing inequities that we're seeing, not just here in Aotearoa, but globally as well, and how those things impact on Indigenous rights, Indigenous health outcomes. So trying to bring all these things together, which tends to happen with these big picture issues like the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So here's a pretty rough outline of what I'm going to go through today. A little bit of kind of background about trade agreements and health. A bit more focus on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which has now been superseded, but it does help to understand some of the sort of historical context to this and some of the issues that were around with that previous deal. And I'll talk through some of those issues, particularly in relation to health and equity and Indigenous rights. And then look at what's new or what's different and what's still the same in the rebranded Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, the so-called Comprehensive and Progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership. Now, there's a bit of good positive spin for you, isn't it? Who could have any issue with that kind of deal? And what I'll particularly be doing is looking at that through the lens of climate change and health and how the deal can potentially have some adverse impacts on our ability to respond to the climate crisis. And lastly, just share some thoughts around what we as health professionals and academics can do, particularly, as I mentioned, we're in the middle of a public consultation process around the TPP. Even though it's been signed, we can still have our say. So I'll share some thoughts with you about that at the end. Okay, so yeah, as our NZMJ editorial said, for us as health professionals who don't necessarily have any expertise around trade agreements or, you know, even some of the legal, financial and other issues, can be perceived as pretty boring. And even for me, having kind of looked at these things and the implications, I still eyes glaze over a little bit, particularly around some of the technical and legal kind of language in there. Highly political, and so tend to be driven very much by political imperatives rather than, you know, particularly for us, what's best for population health or equity. But they are incredibly important, as I hope to show. And part of the reason for that is that the scope of these agreements has really expanded hugely. And it's not just about the narrow kind of ideas around trade that we might have been used to, but it's extending into domestic regulation, labour laws, environmental protection, and a lot of things that have implications for public health. Oh, so sorry, I should go back and just explain what that picture is. I saw George smiling away there. Down the bottom there, you might, those of you who know George Laking here, he's just finished doing 3,000 kilometres from Cape Ranga to the Bluff on that bicycle. And the reason for that is I think that the TPP and other trade agreements have real implications for our sovereignty, our self-determination. So I like the kind of tino rangatiratanga kind of imagery and also the other sort of imagery that goes along with that. So kia ora, George. Sorry about that. So the Trans-Pacific Partnership, as I said, it's worth revisiting a few of the issues that were there with the original deal. And so the timeline actually goes back to 2008 when negotiations originally started. It was signed in Auckland in 2016. And as probably everyone knows, after President Trump came into power, the US very quickly withdrew. So that was January 2017. And then earlier last year, the remaining 11 countries decided to resurrect the deal and rebranded it as the CPTPP. And that was eventually signed in March 2018 after having been agreed earlier this year. So what were some of the major concerns with the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement? In general, a lot of the concerns from civil society, from other groups, were about the fact that it's not really just about trade. In fact, trade was a relatively minor part of it in terms of the things that we usually associate, like tariffs and subsidies and those kind of boring things. And it was much more about some of those other things around intellectual property, around environmental regulations and really controlling what governments could do. And also due to some power imbalances in the negotiation process, particularly concerns about the level of United States control over the whole thing. And as a health community, we were also really concerned. So this is just a few examples of some action that was taken by health professionals, media items, other things, you know, letters to ministers, things that were done to try to really get the government to slow things down, have a look, you know, do a proper analysis of what the impacts of this really far-reaching agreement might be. And what were some of the health concerns specifically? Well, access to medicines was a really important one. But alongside that, threats to healthy public policy in a number of different areas, so tobacco, food, alcohol, environmental health, just to name a few. The reason I've got tobacco there in sort of brackets is eventually there was a carve-out in the TPPA for tobacco so that none of the provisions would apply to tobacco. So that's not wouldn't have been so as affected as some of those other areas. And more broadly, really, a concern around increasing social and economic inequities. You know, so who would the economic benefits of this deal, which were sort of being touted by the government and by our negotiators, who would those benefits largely accrue to? Would it be, you know, disadvantaged Māori communities, or would it be the large corporates and the people that run those and people associated with the big business? So let's just quickly go through each of those in turn, just so we've got a little bit of background around what those concerns were. So, oh, here's George again. Access to medicines was one of the kind of more obvious issues with the original TPP. And really, at least early on in the negotiations, major concern that it would undermine PharmAc's ability to, you know, give us the good value for money medicines that we currently enjoy. And compared with other countries, you know, you might think that we actually do pay a reasonable amount. But PharmAc has been shown to, you know, deliver incredibly cost-effective medicines and save the health sector considerable money. So that was really a concern about the original TPP. Perhaps one of the major concerns, and particularly for people like me working in this space, was around threats to healthy public policy. And I like this quote, and I like this sort of imagery around handcuffing governments, because it's been a trend with these, not just the TPP, but a lot of other trade agreements, that a lot of it is about sort of restricting governments' policy options or policy space. So one of the mechanisms that these trade agreements use to do that are these things called ISDS, or investor-state dispute settlement provisions. Another example of this great language that gets people's eyes glazing over. And this was one of the major concerns, and still is, about the TPP, that it would entitle foreign investors to sue governments for introducing laws, regulations, policies that we might think, well, we're entitled to do that, we're a sovereign nation. And the issue with that is that the cases are tried in these sort of offshore tribunals. There's real concerns about the legitimacy of those around conflicts of interest and the transparency of those. And you know, this idea here, Margaret Chan from the WHO talking about tobacco, you know, when a tobacco company can sue governments for introducing policies that are designed to, you know, reduce tobacco use, that something's very wrong. And it's not just the things we know about now, but we know that, you know, good, healthy policy should be responsive to new evidence as it becomes available, and should actually prioritise population health over, you know, the interests of corporates and big businesses. And we also know that our future health threats can't always be predicted. We don't necessarily know what tools we're going to require to respond to those things. And so we need to have all these things at our disposal. And we know that powerful interests like tobacco companies, pharmaceutical companies, fossil fuel industry. They've got a long history of using every means, including legal means, to oppose any action that's going to threaten their profitability. Great book there if you want to have a look, particularly in relation to the tobacco industry. And also how those same techniques and same people often are being used in denying climate change and opposing action on climate change. Okay, so the concern is that these agreements can actually tip the balance further in favour of these already very powerful interests. And one of the real concerns about investor-state dispute settlements is around just the chilling effect it can have. So even if we're not putting these policies and this legislation in place and being sued for it, we're often perhaps not going there because we're worried about the threat of legal action and the huge fees that come with that. So even an example from here, which is not an agreement that we were part of, but we were responding to the issues in Australia where plain packaging on cigarettes was being challenged. And so we decided to pass this law back in 2013, and it was only last week that actually came into effect. So that delay was partly due to this, waiting to see what was happening in Australia. Yeah, okay, I'm watching. So you can see the sort of chilling effect that these things have, even the threat of legal action against governments. And one of the things that we should also be concerned about is, as we're getting more of these modern trade agreements, we're seeing an increase in the use of investor-state dispute settlement cases over time. And so apart from the impacts on, medicines and healthy public policy, there were also really broader concerns with the Trans-Pacific Partnership around sort of the economic impacts, and I think in particular the impacts on equity. So, and as I mentioned, one of the things that the government uses to say why we should enter these trade agreements is the economic benefits it will bring. Okay, so being able to export our products to more countries, open up new markets, have more liberalised trade, will bring greater profits, greater income to those companies. But as this quote here from The Lancet says, not everyone's going to gain from that, and so there's real concerns about the distribution of those economic benefits. And you might know Joseph Stiglitz, very famous economist, saying that, these trade deals tend to benefit the wealthiest, the 1% or the 0.1% at the expense of everyone else. So real concerns about the Trans-Pacific Partnership from many different perspectives. And I think for us here in Aotearoa, also very much from an Indigenous rights perspective as well. And in fact, this really awesome fella did a, among other people, my brother, did a review of the Trans-Pacific Partnership in terms of Māori rights and looking at it from a te tiriti or waitangi perspective, and found that effectively it's moving us away from honouring treaty rights, that it fetters the sovereignty of our government. He talks about this chilling effect, and including not being able to fully honour those things we need to do under Te Tiriti, Declaration of Independence, Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and also just the things that we should be doing as a matter of social justice. And goes further to say that the Treaty of Waitangi exception, which is one thing that the government has been, kind of using to say, well, that may be the case, but we've got in the agreement an exception that excludes anything that's going to breach the Treaty of Waitangi. But this analysis found that actually it didn't secure full protection for those treaty rights. So that's why back when the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement was being negotiated, a group of esteemed Māori leaders, including including our tumuaki, took a claim to the Waitangi Tribunal. Okay, now, that didn't really come to much, but yeah, they found against it. But there were obviously sufficient concerns there that the Trans-Pacific Partnership would breach the treaty if it was entered into. And so if we look at the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and the CPTPP, you know, I would say it's wrong on so many levels. Sorry, I just have to put at least one dad joke into my presentations. Okay, and in fact, that's what's been found. There have been some health impact assessments done or health impact analyses from people in Canada, Australia, and have generally found that there may be potential for some gains in certain areas, but a whole lot of risks and a much greater potential for adverse impacts. Okay, so that's the Trans-Pacific Partnership. What I think has been quite interesting is that, and in fact, many of us who were really opposed to the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement were sort of seeing the one silver lining in the cloud of Donald Trump being elected as president was that the TPP was going to go away. Maybe that was wishful thinking. Because the TPP sort of did go away, but then it was brought back from the dead by, as I said, the other 11 countries. And so, you know, maybe there is some benefit in, or at least the risks are reduced by not having the US in the agreement. But what does it look like now? What are the differences? Should we be as concerned about it as we were back when the TPP was signed and in that process? So the first thing I want to say is that actually the substance of the CPTPP is identical to the TPPA. Okay, there's really nothing in the text that's been materially changed. I'll go on and talk about some of the items in there have been suspended, but not deleted. There are some things that are still in there, like the government's right to regulate in the public interest, Treaty of Waitangi provisions still in there. There's still in there, in terms of the New Zealand perspective, that the Farm Act model is protected. What's different, and perhaps the main difference, is that the USA is not part of the deal anymore. That's important for a number of reasons, partly because some of the provisions that were in there were really in there to appease United States-based companies, multinational companies, and also because the US is one of the main litigators in terms of investor-state dispute settlements, so that reduces the risk of us being sued and those sorts of things. Doesn't take it away, but reduces it because of those US-based companies not being part of this deal. Some of the more controversial provisions have been suspended. And also we have side letters with some countries that exclude some aspects of the deal. I'll talk a little bit more about that very soon. So what happened when just before the CPTPP was signed is that they released the text and the New Zealand government released what's called a national interest analysis. And you may or may not have seen this or read about it in the news, but it was, again, quite a positive spin. Really emphasising the rise in GDP, the new markets that we'd have opportunities to get into, downplaying the risks. And so the sort of language in the national interest analysis is, you know, narrowing the scope of investor-state dispute settlements, keeping the right government's right to regulate for legitimate public policy, strong safeguards, these kinds of things. And I like what one of my colleagues said about this document, which is, We should really read it with the same level of scepticism that we would a pharmaceutical company writing about their own product. You know, so this is really government department writing this analysis that's been part of the negotiations and, you know, would obviously want to justify why they might be entering into this deal. So that's the kind of angle we want to look at it from. So what we've done is that we, a group of us, Oliver Hales, who's a young legal scholar, and a few of us from the health sector, looked at the New Deal and what the implications were for human health, and looking at it through the lens of climate change and climate action. And just in case anyone needs a reminder, you know, climate change has been described as one of our biggest threats and defining health issue of the 21st century. It has, you know, will have potentially far-reaching impacts on health. And so, yeah, I didn't do this flash slide, but I quite like it, so I'm going to use it in all my presentations now. And we see things that are, you know, more direct impacts from things like extreme heat, weather events, those sorts of things, through to much more indirect impacts caused by social, political, economic changes. And we see this in a number of different areas. Okay, so just making the point really that climate change is a really key health issue. We're already starting to see some impacts, but those are likely to be much, much greater as we move into the future. Also a reminder that those impacts won't be evenly distributed, and Māori, other Indigenous peoples, other disadvantaged populations face greater impacts and will have usually less potential to adapt to the impacts of climate change due to things like colonisation, marginalisation, socioeconomic deprivation. So those are just a few of the reasons why you know, Māori in New Zealand might be more at risk of the impacts of climate change. But it's not all doom and gloom. So we also look at climate change as, and it's been described in The Lancet again as perhaps the greatest global health opportunity of the 21st century. So that if we tackle climate change in the right way, we can actually improve health and improve equity. So anything that threatens our ability to act to address climate change threatens our ability to protect health longer term, but also can stop us doing some of these things that we need to do in the very immediate term to address health issues and health equity. So, what's the deal with CPTPP and climate change? Interestingly, the term climate change is not in the text at all, and it's quite instructive to sort of read through and look at the language and how environmental concerns are certainly in the agreement, but the sort of, you know, the language is very soft around those, contrasting very starkly with some of the more direct and enforceable rules around protecting corporate interests. So the way that we certainly see this, having looked at it from this perspective, is really a backdoor mechanism to constrain our ability to, you know, to have that sovereign lawmaking ability. Now, what the government, as I've said earlier, will say is that all the agreement does contain a safeguard. So this is it here. See if you can read it without falling asleep. And so there's a thing in there about protecting legitimate public welfare objectives, and it includes public health in there. So you might say, oh, well, we should be reassured by that. There's, you know, the safeguards there. The government's free to do stuff as long as it's legitimately in the public health interest and the public interest. But what we have to look at is the qualifications that are in there. So words like non-discriminatory, legitimate, except in rare circumstances, some of these sort of exemptions, they might not look like much to us because we might think, well, in general, this is a really positive thing. But these are exactly the sorts of things that, you know, teams of lawyers are paid large sums. These are the sort of loopholes that they're, you know, paid to exploit. And so we should be actually quite concerned about those things. Now, what about the suspended items? So one of those, and I'm particularly talking about the investor-state dispute settlements here, is there has been a change to that. There's been a sort of limiting of the extent of those provisions. And so if the dispute is about a private contract with the New Zealand government, then that is now exempt from any investor-state dispute settlement. Okay, so that a multinational company who's got a contract with the government to deliver whatever can't sue the government on the basis of this agreement. And also there are some countries now that we have side letters with that have exempted the use of investor-state dispute settlements. But the key thing here is that the disputes around private contracts with the government were never really the core issue. And it's, you know, a relatively rare thing that might result in a investor-state dispute case. And so it really does nothing to address some of those core issues around ISDS. And also, as I mentioned, they're just suspensions so that if the US decides at some point to rejoin, it's very likely that those things would just be, the suspensions would be abandoned and those provisions would just be reinstated as they were in the original TPP. So we also are really concerned about just the overall impact of the CPTPP. Again, looking at it through the lens of climate change and impacts on climate action, the fundamental objective is about protecting business interests. Those of you who might have looked through some of the text, that's the way it's framed. And the impact there is to make it more difficult for governments like ours to regulate in response to public health and environmental risks. So, why does that matter? And I'm really focusing here on what we need to do to address climate change and alongside that improve health and equity. So the key point here is that if we're going to effectively tackle climate change, we're going to have to turn things around really quickly from where we are now. So up till 2011, we'd already emitted 2/3 of our total carbon budget. That means that if we don't want to exceed these thresholds, after which, you know, we run into potentially catastrophic impacts, we need to seriously limit greenhouse gas emissions and reduce them to zero very quickly. And in terms of how quickly that might be, this graph is quite interesting, and there's a little bit in there, but essentially what it's telling us is that if we want to stay within a reasonable limit, and by that they mean 1.5 or 2 degrees above pre-industrial temperatures, we've got a mean budget of around 600 gigatons. Okay? And to keep within that, we're going to have to reduce to zero within the next 20, 30 years or so. And how we do that, the quicker we do it, the quicker we start, obviously the more gradually we can reduce. If we push it out to 2025 to peak global emissions, we're going to have to really dramatically reduce to zero over a space of 10 years or so, which many people think would be just too difficult to the extent where it's impossible. So what this paper here, and the reason it was called 3 years to safeguard our climate, was because if we haven't peaked by 2020, we're in real trouble. And if we're not heading down very, very quickly after that, again, we're in real trouble. So this is effectively telling us that anything that kind of looks like the status quo is going to be trouble. It's not going to get us to where we need to go. And the problem with deals like the CPTPP is that they try to preserve the status quo. They try to guarantee a sort of predictable business environment for corporate investors. And what we need, that's the last thing we need. We need rapid transformation away from the status quo, particularly around climate change, we effectively need the fossil fuel industry to become obsolete within the next 20 years at most. And those legislation and deals like the TPP lock us into the status quo, which, you know, will drive us towards that, those catastrophic impacts. And I think that's really important in the New Zealand context, and in which this government has come in, you know, partly on a platform of really progressive reform and, you know, famously Jacinda Ardern describing climate change as the nuclear-free moment. And it actually has some really good plans around things like a Zero Carbon Act, reforming the emissions trading scheme. So trying to do some really, take some positive steps towards addressing climate change. But on the other hand, looking to enter into the CPTPP, potentially other deals along the way that undermine that whole process and that make it very difficult to do the types of things that we need to do if we're going to actually get to zero carbon within the next 20 years or so. Okay, and I like, this is actually a bit of a quote from our NZMJ paper. I like this idea of, you know, legal headwinds. So, you know, the government will say, well, we've got these safeguards in place, but it's not a binary thing. It's not, you know, you won't be able to take action on climate change. It's just that those things are going to be much more difficult. We're going to have to stop and think, oh, will this affect some multinationals' profit or infect their investment? And just puts a whole lot of roadblocks in the way, in the way of necessary action. As well as a sort of more academic look at things, I also, as I was preparing for this talk, I came across some notes that I'd made for my oral submission on the TPPA when it was going through the process last time. And I thought it was just quite nice to just be reminded that. And here, this was at the end of my oral submission, and I'd finished talking about all the boring technical stuff, although maybe this is still boring and technical for a lot of you. But I was more talking as a father and as a person and just concerned about the way we're heading, where, you know, the things that we might want to do to protect our public interest could be effectively blocked because it might interfere with some corporate, you know, some transnational companies' profits, and where that's just increasing the huge inequities that we see at a global level, and also nationally as well. So that sort of at a bigger picture is, you know, the major issue I have with TPP and deals like this. Okay, so what can we do? This is just really a plea for... for us as health professionals to be informed and to take action. Now, the action you take might be of different kinds, maybe not as, because it was actually a nurse who was the person responsible for throwing the dildo at Stephen Joyce. So we can claim the credit for that as the health community. But there are different ways in which we can engage, and at the moment, I think the key way is through the formal submission process. And originally the date set for that was very, very tight, but they've extended it out to 18th of April. Still pretty cursory sort of attempt at consultation from my my opinion, because it doesn't allow a lot of time for people to get up to speed to make submissions and to make those in a really informed and effective way. But I think the one thing that we can do is we can, you know, look to what people who have looked into this issue in a lot of detail have said and borrow some of those ideas in the way that we might go about submitting. And I think one really simple thing that we can ask for, even if we don't really understand the implications or don't want to get into all the legal technical details, is that we can at least ask for an independent, comprehensive health impact assessment. Including health equity, and including that in a very broad sense, like I've talked about with environmental determinants, other social determinants, rather than just a narrow look at, you know, maybe access to medicines and health, public health policy. And that we think this assessment should be publicly released, open for consultation before we ratify the agreement. Okay, going back to what I said about really the fact that the national interest analysis that we have at the moment is a bit of a positive spin on things and doesn't necessarily adequately critique the deal and look at what the real potential implications. So yeah, just in summary, I think, and the reason I wanted to come and talk about this is really that it does have implications for health and health equity, huge implications, as I hope I've talked about. One of the really concerning things is that it's taking us in a direction that makes it very difficult to address, you know, the defining health issue of our time, the climate crisis. And I think we as the public health community have a really important role to play in advocating, and bearing in mind that this is just one example and there's likely to be other trade agreements. I like to put it in inverted commas because it's most of it's not really about trade. Others coming down the track as well, and we need to be responding to those. And I think the one thing that we can do, probably above all else, is to recommend that we actually get a proper assessment independently of government, and that's done before we ratify the deal. So kia ora, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rhys. I think we've got plenty of time for questions or a discussion. No one wants to start with that?
Yeah? Oh, kia ora. I'm curious about the suspensions. Mm-hmm. Suspensions usually imply that it's off the table for a while. But is there a time frame around the suspensions?
Good question. One thing I have to say, proviso I gave at the beginning was that I'm not an expert on all the ins and outs of the deal. And so if anyone else has more information than I have, please feel free to chip in. But my understanding is that there's not necessarily a time limit on those. There is definitely the ability for those to be sort of reinstated if the United States comes back into the deal. Yeah.
I've asked James.
There's a whole lot of really interesting political stuff around this, I think. And one of the things that I've been puzzled about in some respects is that when Labour and New Zealand First were in opposition, that they were opposed to the deal as it was then. And a lot of the things that they were asking for, like an independent assessment, you know, they now seem to be happy to just enter into it without having done any of that. So I think it's really interesting, and I think there's also a big risk for the current government in not signing up to the deal because of all the benefits that have been touted, by the previous government and then even by our national analysis in this with this deal. So I think that it's politically very challenging, and that possibly in some respects, you know, stuck between a rock and a hard place. And on the one hand, you know, opening us up to considerable risk if we enter into the deal, but on the other hand, probably exposing themselves to a lot of backlash from those who were, you know, expecting to benefit from the deal, and you know, now see this as, or would see it as, walking away from, you know, potential economic gains for our country. And I think a lot of that, you know, maybe the work that they had invested in that would have been really undone if they had have refused to enter into the deal.
Thinking about it this morning, listening on the radio to Labor, the Labor government's ideas around considering restricting fossil fuel exploration and how agreements like this are actually going to prevent them from doing any of the consideration work.
Yeah, and so I think that's a good example. You know, there's been a big protest around ending oil and gas exploration, And if we want to get serious about addressing climate change, we're going to have to stop, you know, issuing those permits for oil and gas exploration. And that is obviously going to interfere with potential profits of fossil fuel companies. And so, yeah, the two just, I don't think, can go together at all. We can't have, do the things that we need to do to address climate change and, on the other hand, have this deal which is handcuffing our government. Yeah, well, I mean, my understanding is that technically we can. Whether politically we might want to do that or not is another question. But, so the deal, even though it's been signed, only comes into effect once, countries have ratified it. And so if we choose not to ratify it and pass legislation that's, you know, will enable us to do that, then, we won't be part of the deal. So we can potentially still do that. Yeah, well, so it was a little bit different with the original TPP because one of the conditions was that it had to be, the US had to ratify it as well as a number of other countries, but without them, it couldn't come into effect. And so Trump could just choose to walk away and it was a dead duck, basically. Well, who knows?
It would surprise nobody.
Yeah. And I think that's the risk is that we might say, well, these things have gone from the current deal, but they can be reinstated at any moment. So, yeah, there's still that risk. That's something I've been wondering as well, and I've never really had a good answer to that. What's stopping us from doing a health impact assessment? I guess it would just be delay the process for one thing, but also you know, perhaps introduce questions and provide some answers that the government might not want to hear at the moment. Yeah.
Now you might want to come and see Rhys after, but on behalf of everyone here, I'd just like to thank you, Rhys, for your amazing Technicolor PowerPoint display this afternoon.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, just about that, I do have to acknowledge I did borrow quite a few of the slides and pictures from, particularly from Josh Freeman, who's one of our colleagues who's working in this area and knows a lot about trade agreements and health, and particularly around the TPP. So. Yeah, mihi to Josh.
Yeah, and to you, and big props to you and your colleagues for all the work that you're doing and reminding us that sometimes we do actually have to get up off from behind our desks to do some good work. So thank you, Rhys, for your time today.